This show is produced by the Hartman Media Company. For more information and links to all our great podcasts, visit hartmanmedia.com.
Welcome to the American Monetary Association's podcast, where we explore how monetary policy impacts the real lives of real people and the action steps necessary to preserve wealth and enhance one's lifestyle.
Welcome to the Terminal Value Podcast. I'm Doug Utberg, and I have Jason Hartman on the line. And this will also actually be on the Creating Wealth Podcast, which is Jason's podcast that has far more listeners than mine does at this current juncture. Of course, Jason also has about a 13-year head start.
Actually, 15 years. Yeah. So don't feel bad, Doug. Nobody listened to my show in the beginning either.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, he's a 15-year overnight success in the podcasting world.
Exactly.
But I've actually known Jason for a really long time. He runs an extremely successful investment real estate company, but he does it a little differently because a lot of people like to invest in real estate, say in their own state. But when he started the company, he was in California and everything in California was ridiculously expensive. So he came up with the idea of investing out of state for cash flow in areas that have much more reasonable prices and much more, I guess you'd say, rational relationships between rent and values so that you could get decent cash flow. Jason, let me stop talking for a second and let you introduce yourself to the audience.
Thanks, Doug. And it's great to talk to you. And so we'll do this as kind of a co-interview.
Absolutely.
You've been on my show many, many times over the years, and we've talked about a lot of interesting macroeconomic concepts. You always have really interesting views and angles on things. So anxious to dive in and talk about the market, the potential bubble that some are talking about, and just some macro issues and real estate and how they all tie together.
Yeah, absolutely. Because I think the thing is, right, you know, in my heart, I'm a value guy. I'm a kind of born contrarian, right? You know, I'm an ardent believer that over the long term, the herd is always wrong. The problem is that long term can take a while to show up. And so because, you know, I think as you've said, right, with the current low interest rates, there's basically a bull market that's happening in everything, right? You know, the equities are going to the moon, real estate's going to the moon. You know, my intuition is that this can't last forever, but it probably will last a few more years.
Yeah.
And incidentally, that's actually one of the reasons why bears tend to do really bad is because, you know, what bears will almost always say, or like what contrarians will say, is they'll say, hey, the market's overvalued, and they're right. And then it goes up another 30%. They say the market's even more overvalued.
And they keep missing it.
And it goes up another 30%. Yeah. And by that point, they're wiped out.
Right.
And then when the inevitable correction comes and the market goes down by 60% or whatever, they're out of the market because they were, you know, because they were betting on the decline. And it's just so hard to call a top.
Of course.
I know everything's high, but I have no clue where the top is going to be.
Sure. Yeah. Now, market timing is a fool's errand. You spelled it out perfectly. You know, the people who win are the people who embody the value investing philosophy, and they buy good assets, regardless of what the type of asset is. We can talk about that, of course.
Yeah.
And they hold on to them, and they just manage them, and they keep them, and they watch them grow over time. And those are the people that succeed.
And then one of the other things I think that you and I have talked about a few times, either at conferences or whatever, is that, you know, in the mainstream media, everybody likes to talk about, you know, stocks, bonds, you know, kind of stuff that you, mutual funds you get through your financial advisor. That's a way that you can amass some assets. But the way that people become really wealthy, there's really only two ways. And that's either through real estate or through a business that they start and grow, and then it grows at just a meteoric rate because, you know, businesses either fail or they grow rapidly. And so I think that's one of the other things to think about also, just, you know, one of the things I think about macro-wise is that right now you're actually seeing a lot of concentration in kind of the technopoly. I know this is one of your hot buttons is big tech and just how big tech is getting just so much bigger. And a lot of small businesses are just really suffering.
Now, it's really an unfair system we have. We have this winner-take-all system.
Yeah.
Listen, you know, I don't expect it to be fair. I said fair, and that's probably the wrong word. We have a system that is essentially a scam. It's a winner-take-all system where big, giant, evil tech companies are the new dictators. They're the new censors. They have armies of lobbyists, lawyers, accountants to, you know, manipulate the law in their favor, pull the wool over your eyes, fight you in court. You're just not going to win. And there is some hope because finally the government, and I'm no big government fan, but finally the government appears to be doing their job, the job they should have done 15 years ago, filing antitrust complaints against these companies because they are just totally abusive. It is ridiculous. No matter what side of the political aisle you're on, you should be very scared that we are living in this Orwellian disaster of a world. Doug, it's like, and we've talked about these concepts over the years, but we're living in a world of not only Orwellian 1984, but also Brave New World, Aldous Huxley's book, and Ayn Rand's Atlas Shrugged, and, you know, I don't know, a bunch of others. It's just a dystopian disaster we're living under with these big tech companies.
And by the way, I'm just going to say, for any younger listeners, what we're talking about, a thing, it's called a book. It's made with paper and glue. They have them in these buildings. You might drive by them every now and then. It's called a library.
Actually, and you can visit all the homeless people that live in the library, because, you know, that's a whole problem that's absurd, that it was created by the government. But yeah, it's a whole other discussion. But yeah, these big tech companies, it's awful. And you know, we agreed on something a long time ago, Doug, that real businesses make money.
Make money.
You know, and we've seen with, you know, a whole new slew of IPOs, these basically zombie companies that the way they make money is by raising money. That's all they do. They don't have real businesses. It's absurd.
Well, I mean, and that's what I should, you know, disclaimer alert, right? I'm not giving investment advice, but I mean, that's basically what Tesla did, at least in my view. I don't think they're really making money now. I think they're just cooking the books to make it look like they're generating profits.
Elon Musk is a master of financial manipulation.
Yeah. All of the equity on their balance sheet is because they sold convertible bonds. The stock went up. It converted to stock, but, you know, they don't have any retained earnings. They have no retained earnings. But anyway, that's another topic for another day. One of my many, many rants.
Yeah.
But the thing that I think is actually particularly dangerous about the big tech, especially like Facebook, is just the utter and complete destruction of people's ability to have civil conversations and to focus. Fantastic book I read recently, Deep Work by Cal Newport.
I had Cal on the show to talk about that book. I interviewed
him. Outstanding. Yeah, it's a wonderful book. I've read it a couple of times, and every time I read it, it just really makes me think about how important it is to really be able to focus and avoid getting distracted, because it's just so easy. It's like, I mean, I don't think it's any less addicting than like tobacco or anything. I would say that the kind of the information addiction is probably even worse than a lot of substances. But it just kind of gets ignored. I'm actually really concerned that, you know, the social media and the kind of the online technopoly is just really deteriorating people's mental health. I mean, you're already seeing it. Suicide rates are just going through the roof. Not that anybody's talking about it.
It's terrible.
The only thing they're talking about is the mortality counter for COVID. You know, there's a way bigger problems that are brewing under the surface and just totally ignored.
No, I know. You're absolutely right. It's really a dystopian world we live in. But, you know, at the same time, there's a lot of opportunity. So if we want to circle over to like the direct economic issues, you'd probably agree, although we haven't talked about this, Doug, but you'd probably agree with the concept of the K-shaped recovery, right? I'm guessing you would. So it's very uneven, right?
Yeah.
Some people are really suffering and some people are just killing it. And there's some are in between. The ultra wealthy are killing it right now. They've become insanely rich. That's just part of the winner-take-all world in which we live, and it's unfortunate because it's not democratic. It's very anti-democratic. It's not capitalistic. It's crony.
No.
It's too bad. But look, we can complain all we want. We're not going to change it. The thing we have to do is align our interests with the most powerful forces the world has ever known, and I've always said those are governments and central banks.
Yep.
Let's talk about that, because we've had endless conversations over the years about that.
Exactly. One of the things that I think is actually really, really unique about the investing model that you put forward is, you know, is the idea that your asset when you have a rental property is really that you have a item of universal need, right? A house, place for someone to live, where the rent offsets your debt service. So then in that case, what you're ultimately doing is over the long term, you're just levering inflation. You know, so then, you know, even if inflation is the reported 3-4%, which of course, with the amount of money that's being printed now, that's nonsense. There's going to be inflation at some point. You can't not have it. We've been saying that for 10 years, but it's going to happen eventually. Just so
it has happened. You know, I mean, there's a lot more inflation in the system than the government would say. Yeah, it's just ridiculous. You know, there's much more inflation in there.
But I was going to say the, but like, you know, even if there's only that 3-4% inflation, you know, if you're at a 4-1 leverage ratio, right? You know, say you have 80% loan to value, borrowing $4 for every one of your dollars that's in there, and then your cash flow is offsetting your debt service, then over time, as the value inflates, you're just going to get, you'll end up getting a net multiplier on whatever that increase in value is. And the thing is, right, you don't know in advance what's going to go up. So what you do is you just say, okay, you know, I'm going to spread my bets across the board. And, you know, over time, I know that that rising inflation tide is going to lift the nominal price of all the boats, you know, but the thing that's really valuable is actually that fixed rate loan, because that's what gives you that cheap money that, you know, where you're debt service stays flat, but the nominal value of your asset goes up, and it really gives you a chance to lever inflation in what I call a real way, right? You know, you're not depending on the inflation. It's just inflation's inevitable, and you're just aligning your interests with it. I think that's one of the things is because, yeah, the, you know, equity markets won't grow at 20% forever. Like the, I think the 80, 90 year average is something like 8% a year. And a lot of people don't know this, but the biggest peak to valley drop of the S&P 500 in history was, of course, you know, after the 1929 crash, but that was 86%. If it has happened before, it can happen again.
Right.
People always say, okay, buy the dips because it always comes back. Not necessarily. Somebody should look at the Nikkei. The Nikkei has never come back. And right. It peaked in 1990. And I think it's only like 60% of that peak value. You know, you're just because something always has happened doesn't mean it always will.
Right.
That's something that a lot of people really have a hard time wrapping their head around.
No question about it. The stock market is a two-dimensional asset class at best, and many times just a one-dimensional asset class. But income property is a multidimensional asset class. So you make money in several ways. You earn your return in several ways. And the sad thing about it, Doug, is that so many people just don't know how to do the math. They could have had income properties over the years in the past, and they just didn't think it was that great for whatever reason. Or they're looking at it now and they think, and they listen to Cramer or some liar who's saying, well, you know, the S&P will typically do 8% and property only goes up at about 6%. But that's not the reality of the situation. The reality of the situation is because you earn so many forms of return on your income property, it's a multidimensional asset class. You know, a 6% appreciation all in on a good income property turns into a 25 or 30% annualized return on investment. You know, you can see these performers at jasonhartman.com in the properties page for details, because some of you may not believe those numbers, but they're all spelled out. And I've got a video on the front page of my website that spells it out.
It's a good video. I mean, and I think that's just it, is that, you know, especially because, yeah, when you're talking about like the S&P 500, what people don't understand is that nobody buys property for cash. I mean, actually even the hedge funds don't buy it for cash. What they do is, you know, they just underwrite it with bonds on the back end. But I think the thing that is appealing to me is that I think it's very much a Main Street way of doing business, right? You know, which is buying real property with bank financed loans. That's, you know, people have been, you know, that's a never going away. That's one of the oldest lines of business for every bank, because, you know, banks will underwrite real estate all day long because they like writing debt on real assets.
Sure.
And at some point in the future, people are going to get more picky about what kind of debt they underwrite. It obviously isn't happening now, but it's going to happen at some point. But I think, you know, just the idea that, you know, not being dependent on a speculative fever pitch. I mean, of course, you know, if you happen to hit the jackpot on a speculative fever pitch, great. But yeah, you don't want to be dependent on it. That's one of the things that I really like about your model. I think it's also, you know, I really like about the philosophy, which is the Main Street versus Wall Street. I mean, everybody who's listened to you talk for more than 5 seconds knows you're no fan of Wall Street.
As I always say, Doug, Wall Street is the modern version of organized crime.
I think there was one conversation we had from a long time ago you just reminded me of that I wanted to bring up to the audience. So I've been at Jason's conferences for a really long time, and I think it was in 2012.
And you've been a speaker at some of our conferences too.
Yeah, I've been a speaker at the conferences a few times. In 2012, when we were talking about Bitcoin, and I think Jason reminded me of my line at the time, and I said, you know, when Bitcoin is traded on in ETFs and futures, then we'll know it's real. Well, it's traded in ETFs and futures, so I think that probably means Bitcoin's actually real. Well, and also, if you're a company, like I just saw that I think it was the Department of Energy just had a huge cyber attack. So it's like, yeah, you know, if you have to pay off cyber hackers, they only accept Bitcoin. because I know this, you know, when I was in the IT department, one of the things we had to do is we had to open up a Coinbase account so that we could have a small
so that you could pay your ransom.
So yeah. that if we had to pay ransom, wow. then we would have Bitcoin stored up. Yeah.
That is sad. You're almost making the case, though, for the government to make it illegal. That's what worries me. But yeah, I get it. I get it. Yeah.
I'd be really interested to see. Yeah. If Bitcoin gets shut down, then do the cyber hackers go to some other crypto or what would happen? That would be a. I'm not sure that I really want to know. I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. It's a hugely speculative question, but it's a good question. You know, hopefully no one ever has to experience that. But, you know, one of the things that I think is really interesting to note is that when you see all of these pundits on TV and so forth, and they're talking about, oh, there's a bubble, and let's just use real estate as an example. Sure. We could use the stock market or anything else, but real estate has some particular interesting things. Okay. So real estate has actually gotten cheaper over the last 14 years. The difference when you adjust for the median house price and the 30-year mortgage interest rate on a 30-year fixed rate mortgage and inflation, you adjust for those three things. Yeah. Now, I'm not adjusting for wages. Okay. I just want to make that clear. Yeah. But I don't know that you need to that much. It wouldn't make that much of a difference. The concept still is definitely the same. So when you adjust for inflation, interest rates, and the price of the house, which is much higher, for example, median price now is about $313,000. Mm-hmm. Median price 14 years ago before the Great Recession was, I think, about $235,000. Okay. But the interest rate is much lower now. So the real dollar difference in mortgage payments is $657 less today than it was 14 years ago. So houses have gotten cheaper, contrary to popular belief. You'll see all the idiots on CNBC saying, you know, if you look at the price of a house now, it's higher than it was before the Great Recession. So there must be a bubble. Things are going to crash. And they'll miss the whole thing because nobody buys the house based on the price. They all buy it based on the payment. And right. that's the reality of the situation. So real estate is a bargain. Okay. It's gotten cheaper, especially good quality suburban real estate in linear markets. You know, we're not recommending high flying cyclical markets. We're not recommending trophy markets. We're certainly not recommending urban areas and high density areas because they suffer from a concern about COVID, of course, but they also suffer from a concern about Joe Biden campaign rallies. I mean, riots where people are breaking windows and burning buildings. I mean, Joe Biden campaign rallies, riots. Oh, same thing. Anyway, yeah. And we should note that when I say Joe Biden campaign rally, I'm talking post-election. They're still going on.
Everything's going crazy.
Yeah, the world is nuts. It really is.
Yeah, the world is absolutely nuts. But I think that the point that you made there, I think is for everybody who's listening is really important, which is that the thing to really think about is, you know, what's going to be your mortgage payment and debt service? And that the real value of that or the real cost of that is actually on, you know, for a median value house has actually gone down.
It's lower.
The median rent has gone up.
Yep.
You know, so it's like, even though real estate prices have gone up, there's a lot of cases where real estate is still actually a better deal than it was 14 years ago.
No question about it. It is a better deal than it was 14 years ago. And that's why prices keep going up and there are bidding wars and the market is going crazy. Now, you asked earlier, though, Doug, about, you know, the low interest rates, can they last? No, of course they can't last. They're artificial. They can only defy gravity for so long. Eventually, interest rates have to become normal. Okay. But here's an interesting thing. You might remember Patrick, one of our team members, who lives in a rent-controlled house with his wife in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. They rented this house back in 1996, and I think they're paying $2,400 a month rent now, and the price of the property value keeps going up and up and up, and it has for many years. Of course, we all know what happened there until recently. Now it's reversing and going the other way with the COVID and the Joe Biden campaign rallies. But before that, the price had gone up a lot. So that house now is worth about $2.4 million, and they're only paying $2,400 a month. So they've got a bargain. Patrick and his wife, Robin, would really like to move, but guess what? They can't make any logical sense because they've got too good a deal. So rent control causes a market to stagnate. It distorts the market. But the same thing, my prediction, I'm making a prediction now, will be true.
This makes a lot of predictions, and a fair amount of them actually happen. The interest rate one, not so much.
No, I'm terrible at predicting interest rates, but I do know the effect of interest rates. So listen to this idea, okay? So in the future, when rates do finally go up as they must, the market will become more stagnant, where people will stay in their houses because they've got that incredible mortgage that doesn't have to be paid off until 2050. They won't want to give that mortgage up. It's like a rent-controlled apartment.
Ostensibly,
that is,
yes.
It is too good a deal to give up. So guess what will happen? That'll restrict supply in the future. There'll be a lower supply of real estate because people aren't trading it. And you'll see a constraint on the supply, which will put upward pressure on rents and prices. But not only that, if you're thinking of what's the business opportunity or, you know, what's the hot investment, well, home improvement will increase as it already has in the COVID world. There will be a lot more interest in adding on a room, adding on a second story, improving the house, fixing it up, buying new furniture, whatever, because people won't move. They'll stay put because if they leave, if they move, they get rid of the mortgage. The most they might do, because these rates are so incredible and they'll never want to give them up, they might turn the property into rental. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then buy another property or rent another property. So that's an interesting effect that I think is going to be hugely significant, you know, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years in the future, because people just aren't going to give up these great mortgages. They're just too good to give them up.
Yeah, no, exactly. No, I think you're exactly right. And I know that's one of the things that I kick myself about constantly is some of the times when I've moved in the past, I'm like, why didn't I just keep that thing and make it a rental? Why did I sell it? Especially because a lot of times when I sold it after the fees, I didn't even make that much money.
I mean, I remember one of your houses that I actually helped you sell. Yep. That wouldn't have made a very good rental. You know, it was too expensive to be a good rental. You know, rental houses should be inexpensive necessity type housing, bread and butter housing. So don't feel so bad about that.
Well, because the thing I think is that, right, you know, even if I'd had to eat a little bit of a monthly for a few years, just being able to have that low interest rate debt with an inflating asset, even if you're not pulling in a big monthly, I think, you know, that's, you know, over the long term, that's powerful.
Sure. Yeah, it is. Yeah. No question about it. The mortgage is the asset. That's what people don't realize. The mortgage is a huge part of the asset. It's not just about the house. It's about the mortgage. I mean, if I could go get 100 of these super cheap mortgages without even having a house attached to it, where I just get income from it equivalent to the rent, I would do that all day long. Forget about the house. I just want the mortgage. The mortgage is such a good deal.
Yeah, well, exactly. It's just because the financing is just so unbelievably favorable.
Yeah. We've been given a gift by our rich uncle, Jerome Powell. That's a joke, obviously, but Jerome Powell is the Federal Reserve Chairman. He's a Keynesian, and he has just made no bones about it. We don't care about inflation. We're going to keep rates low, and everybody should just stock up on these incredibly cheap mortgages as fast as they can.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Absolutely. Because it's one of the two ways that people actually become wealthy. Your other one is to start and grow a business. Yep. You know, those are your two ways that it actually happens.
You're absolutely right. It's either income property or a business. That's about it. Everything else is more of a hedging strategy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. You know, everything else, you can either pay the bills. You might be able to do all right. If you really want to make a jump, it's either going to be real estate or business. That's where it comes from.
Couldn't agree more.
All right. Well, cap us off with one of your famous thoughts.
I don't know. how about this one? Invest in places that make sense so you can afford to live in places that don't make sense.
Hey, where did you hear that first?
I think I heard it from you, and that's why it's
correct,
perfect.
Yeah.
That's why it was the perfect cap off for your show. It wouldn't be the thing I would typically say.
I said that to a coworker one time because he asked me why I was buying houses out in the middle of nowhere. And I was like, I go, well, it's because, I invest in markets that are reasonable and make sense so I can afford to live in one that isn't.
But Doug, those houses are not in the middle of nowhere anymore. If you think about it right now, the whole country is moving to these second and third tier suburban markets. Yep. So Atlanta is booming. So many of our markets in Florida are booming. Memphis has just been a perennial excellent cash flow market, as has Indianapolis. Yep. Again, these aren't trophy cities, but financially they make great sense. They really do. So
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. All right. Well, hey, thank you very much, Jason. That was an awesome conversation.
And thank you, Doug, and happy investing. Thank you so much for listening. Please be sure to subscribe so that you don't miss any episodes. Be sure to check out the show's specific website and our general website, hartmanmedia.com, for appropriate disclaimers and terms of service. Remember that guest opinions are their own. And if you require specific legal or tax advice or advice in any other specialized area, please consult an appropriate professional. And we also very much appreciate you reviewing the show. Please go to iTunes or Stitcher Radio or whatever platform you're using and write a review for the show. We would very much appreciate that. And be sure to make it official and subscribe so you do not miss any episodes. We look forward to seeing you on the next episode.